call this meeting. I'm gonna call this meeting to order. Calling the meeting to order. This is the House Energy Utilities and Telecommunications Committee calling to order right now. Appreciate everybody being here, members and those from the public. We have a bill we're gonna take up, then we have a presentation and then a discussion about rooftop solar. And in particular about how it how that affects the grid. I think that's where I'm kind of coming from, the perspective we're looking at. So with that, we had a bill in subcommittee, House Bill 761, by Representative John Carson, Vice Chairman of this committee, in the Energy Subcommittee. Chairman Martin, do you have a report?
Chairman Parsons, your Energy Subcommittee of the House Energy Utilities and Telecommunications full committee would like to report out to you LC 364203S. That's House Bill 761 with a due pass recommendation by substitute.
Okay. And you have a substitute, is that correct?
That is the substitute. That is a substitute. Yes, sir. That was what was passed out. That's what you have in your packet.
Okay. All right, before we call on Vice Chairman Carson, I did forget something, and that is we'll ask Representative Cantrell if you would lead us in a word of prayer and ask the Lord's blessing on our meeting today.
All right, let's pray together. Father, thank you for the opportunity to be here together this afternoon, and Lord, we come to you again recognizing our need for your wisdom and your perspective on things. So we're asking you to give it to us. You said in your word that if we asked, you would provide it, so we're asking for it during this time today. Guide our time, bless us through it. In Christ's name, amen. Amen.
All right. Vice Chairman Carson, you have this bill that just been brought to us by a subcommittee. You want to talk about it?
Come out there?
Anywhere. You can do it right there if you want
okay.
to.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Chairman Martin, just as Chairman Martin mentioned, House Bill 761, what this is doing is revising the statutory cap that an EMC can hold in a natural gas marketing affiliate. This is going from 15% to 60%. The 15% was put in the bill in 2002 when our General Assembly passed a bill to, as farther follow up on the Natural Gas Deregulation Act, we believe the 15% came as a part of just an additional protection or what have you, from what is known as RUS, or Rural Utility Standards. However, not all EMCs use these RUS financing, and federal rules would apply over state law anyways. So what we're doing with this is we're gonna allow Georgia-based companies to grow and keep some of those jobs in Georgia. As a result, I appreciate the subcommittee chairman's indulgence. As some of you know, this bill has gone through a lot of discussion, a number of changes, but I think we've arrived at a good, happy compromise for right now, and I would ask for the committee's favorable consideration.
I know that the subcommittee had hearings that had open for testimony from the public, so I'm not going to offer that at this time. However, if anybody in the committee has a question of the author, anyone? I don't see any. What's the will of the committee? Okay, we have a due pass and a second. Is that right? Any discussion? All in favor of what will be the committee substitute to House Bill 761, LC 364203S, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed by saying no? Okay, the bill passes and with a due pass recommendation and is eligible to be taken to rules.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Congratulations for your bill passing. Okay, we have a presentation on the let's go on to the other thing. Okay, apparently we're having technical difficulties with the being able to have the to the, am I on here? Okay, we're going to go on to the solar discussion. And I understand John Giles, President and CEO of Electric Cities of Georgia. I understand you do not have a video or... Are you, I mean, did you want to present it or just present the written statement? Well, okay. I mean, you want to give some kind of a little background or a summary of it or something?
Some small scale stuff, even in our rural communities, but we're looking at this utility scale as maybe a different opportunity to kind of do some of it. So, but I did provide comments.
Okay, that's fine. Yeah. I mean, if you, does Blake, you have those?
Yes, sir. They're
okay.
In the package.
Oh, they're in the package. Okay. Well, while we're waiting here, I guess I should put some, thank you, you can, okay. Put in some kind of context, which I apologize, I haven't. You know, we passed a bill of then Representative Mike Dudgeons about, I don't know, it's been about 4 years ago, something like that, maybe five, that would promote or make it easier, or actually allow for rooftop solar that would be financed by a third party. And there had been resistance to it because I think that some of the incumbent power companies felt like that was an infringement on different things, but I think in particular they felt it was an infringement on the Territorial Act, that somebody could come in and sell, put the rooftop solar on for a homeowner or a business, small business for that matter, and then sell them the put it on free of cost basically, and then sell them the electricity from it. That it was an infringement of the Territorial Act. So Mike, Representative Mike Dudgeon. At that time, he worked really hard. I know for at least a year, worked with a lot of the parties. Got a bill passed that basically everybody was on board with. I don't think there was any real opposition to it when we finally passed it. And it doesn't seem like, and this is not the context that this meeting is about, this presentation or this discussion. I will say it doesn't seem like that it's flourished. I don't think that there's been a lot of rooftop solar put on. But the context of this is, I understand that one of the reasons maybe is that rooftop solar presents much more of a challenge when it comes to distributed generation, that accessing the grid than with the larger utility scale solar. And that's kind of where I'm wanting to come, that's where I'm, what I'm looking at here. And really, if there's or anything that can be identified that is an issue with rooftop solar that needs to be, then we need to go back and look at. That's kind of where I'm coming from. I think that's how I've presented it. That's how I've tried to present this. So it just seems like that hasn't. And then it's not just in Georgia. It's my understanding that across the country this has been an issue, that rooftop, as opposed in some other countries where it's really flourished, in the United States it hasn't very much. And of course the different states have different, some have regulated monopolies, some have, you know, it's an open market. And here in Georgia we have the territorial system where Georgia Power has a part of the state, a smaller geographical part of the state, but a larger number of the customers. The EMCs have a larger part of the state, but because it's more rural, they have a smaller number of the and then we have the electric cities. There's different, different entities that have to be dealt with. But I know that some of the members of the committee, I think, have some questions, and we're looking forward to the presentation. But are we still can't
we're
do
ready
this?
You
said we're ready. We are ready.
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. Okay. So in that case, I tell you what I'm we're going to ask Allie Kelly, who has a relatively short presentation, I think, on the Ray. Very short. She's. I think it'd be better to go ahead and have her come and present, and we'll go back to this. So, anyway, there you go.
Thank you, Chairman Parsons, members of the committee. My name is Allie Kelly. I'm executive director of a nonprofit organization called The Ray. And first, I would like to say thank you for giving me the opportunity to update the committee on the work of The Ray. I'm going to start with a little bit of background information about our work because I'm not certain that everyone on the committee has heard any of the previous presentations about our organization and mission and how we function. Back in 2014, Representative Randy Nix and this body passed a House resolution that was signed by Governor Deal, which designated an 18-mile stretch of Interstate 85 in West Georgia as the Ray C. Anderson Memorial Highway. Not super unique in the fact that highway designations are made every year, fairly common for us to recognize important people to Georgia by designating intersections, highways, and other parts of our transportation system. Ray Anderson was the CEO and the founder of Interface Carpet Company, which he founded in LaGrange, Georgia, and grew that small business into the global leader in the manufacturing, design, and distribution of carpet tiles. Interface is still operating as the dominant carpet supplier in the world, and they're valued at over $1 billion. So when Ray passed away in 2011, it was an appropriate action of state government to recognize his legacy with Interface. Also, Ray pioneered the circular economy principles and corporate sustainability in the mid-1990s and throughout the 2000s. Ray Anderson had a profound impact on Unilever, Coca-Cola, Walmart, many of our global Fortune 50 and Fortune 25 companies, really driving them to be more efficient and thus more sustainable in their production or their manufacturing methods, and really kind of making corporate sustainability the family, the common family word that we are all, you know, really comfortable with now. When the highway was designated as a memorial to Ray Anderson, his family foundation, which he endowed upon his passing with about $50 million of his own personal wealth, the family foundation came up and said, with Ray Anderson's name and legacy now attached to this 18-mile stretch of Interstate 85 in West Georgia, what can we as a foundation do to enable improvements in the transportation sector that can help to improve this 18-mile stretch of highway, but which can also help to impact positively interstates and highways around the country and around the world? And that is what has really given birth to the Ray. We're what is now known as a public-private philanthropic partnership. Everyone here knows about the P3. Once you inject philanthropy into the P3, you get the P4. We're the only P4 in the United States using philanthropy to build transportation infrastructure. We now have a charter with Federal Highways Administration and the Georgia Department of Transportation to utilize this 18-mile stretch of interstate as a living lab for new transportation technologies and innovations. Since our founding, if you will, in 2015, we've installed more than a dozen technology projects. And broadly, those projects are in three or four different buckets or areas. First of all, we lead the country along with Georgia DOT in the deployment of autonomous vehicle infrastructure, as well as connected vehicle infrastructure and digital infrastructure. In addition to smart highway work, we're also doing a lot of work to understand how renewable energy might be generated and transferred or transported utilizing existing transportation assets, and I'll get into a little bit of that work with you today. We're also exploring kind of what Ray Anderson would have called the low-hanging fruit. He used to say, so right, so smart, the things that everyone can do right now today. And those include recycling rubber from scrap tires into high-performing asphalt. We just utilized federal highway funding to pave 4 lane miles of the interstate with rubberized asphalt using the existing GDOT spec, which allows 10% of the sticky binder to be modified with rubber from scrap tires pulled out of dumps. We also have the world's first publicly accessible tire safety station that measures your tire pressure, tread, looks for sidewall damage, can can also weigh in motion and test the tire's temperature, all without you getting out of your car, and it occurs in less than 10 seconds. So we're really broad in our exploration with GDOT and other state DOTs, as well as the Federal Highway Administration, and understanding how existing technology could be better utilized in the transportation sector to achieve better results. Better results for the life safety of our drivers, better results for the businesses that rely on the interstate and highway system to transport their goods, and also, yes, better results for the environment, reducing our degradation of the transportation sector to the environment. What I'd like to focus on for my remaining few minutes, and I promise that this would be short, what I'm here to present to you today as a partnership between Georgia DOT, the Federal Highways Administration, the Georgia Public Service Commission, and Georgia Power is a 1 megawatt solar array, which was recently finished in construction on 4 acres of interstate roadside on the interstate section now known as the Ray at exit 14, which is one of the LaGrange exits. This power plant, if you will, which was constructed 40 feet from the edge of the interstate pavement, will be online later this month. This is a grid project, so Georgia Power will be operating and maintaining the solar power plant for 35 years on the Georgia DOT FHWA interstate right-of-way, and the power will be directed to the grid. These kinds of projects are really interesting for utilities because the grid does exist alongside or adjacent to our interstate and our highway system. So the costs associated with some of the larger, more rural solar sites, the costs associated with transmission and distribution are not experienced with sites that we are able to construct on the right-of-way of the interstate. Yes, this is the first pollinator-friendly solar on an interstate roadside in the U.S. This is the first opportunity for Georgia Power and all of its solar sites to innovate the ground cover of their solar sites with native plants that produce flowers, habitat, and food for bees, butterflies, birds, bats, and other types of species that pollinate our food supply. This is just 1 megawatt on 4 acres, so the scale of the impact of this one site on Georgia agriculture is small, but we can consider the hundreds and hundreds of acres, hundreds of megawatts of solar that Georgia Power and other utilities are constructing in South Georgia, adjacent to working Georgia farms, and we can imagine over a 30-35 year period the pollinator benefit that the energy sector can bring to the ag sector in the state of Georgia simply because of a decision to use pollinator friendly habitat in the solar array instead of using turf grass or gravel. The Ray is working with UT Austin's Energy Institute right now to look at every diamond and cloverleaf interchange on the U.S. interstate system, and to look at all the real estate associated with interstate rest areas. We're creating an online tool that will be available to all 50 state DOTs who want to understand the opportunities to utilize their interstate right-of-way for solar opportunities. We recently, with Georgia Power, flew a drone to capture a video of the site. This is one of the actual stills from the video. What you're seeing in the lower corner of the photo is the northbound lanes of I-85 coming from LaGrange and headed towards Noonan and eventually Atlanta. The southbound lanes are above the northbound lanes, and then of course you see the diamond quadrant with about 2,600 high efficient solar panels. You can see the exit lane that creates the triangle with exit 14, which is the Whitesville Road exit in LaGrange, Georgia. And with that, here's my contact information if anyone has any other questions about this, and I'd like to just show you a short video if I'm able to negotiate the computer here. And here's the video, I think. And I'm not sure, Blake, how to get it to show on the screen, but I can see it on my screen.
Today. I don't know why it's not popping up.
Okay. Okay. Oh, look at that.
I like you. You're a good man to have around.
Thank you. Thank you, Wilson. So, is it gonna? Those are solar panels, ground mounted in rows. Thank you, Wilson.
And how
many is that? So it's 2,600, well, nearly 2,600 total high efficient solar panels, ground mounted in rows.
And so that's on the 18-mile stretch?
It is. It's in one quarter of an exit quadrant. So the exits typically have triangle quadrants that create a diamond in groups of four, so this is a traditional diamond interchange. You know, kind of like ask the question, why would you do this, right? So our state DOT and other state DOTs spend millions and millions of dollars maintaining the rights of way and turf grass. They have to maintain a safety setback of at least 40 feet for a high speed thoroughfare like an interstate where you have speeds of, you know, 60 or 70 miles per hour speed limits. So on day one, Georgia DOT transferred this land, the rights to this land, or the access, not the rights, but the access to this land to Georgia Power, and Georgia Power took on the maintenance obligations for this parcel of land. This is an opportunity for Georgia DOT without any other benefit to begin reducing the tens of millions of dollars of obligations related to their roadside maintenance costs. It's also an opportunity for DOTs in Georgia or in other states. According to the Federal Highways Administration, DOTs can negotiate a land fee, which would be valid over the period of the term. In this case, it's a 35-year period. DOTs could also negotiate with a utility or a solar developer lower energy costs through a power purchase agreement related to each and every one of these sites. Also, every solar site generates renewable energy credits, and not necessarily possible with Georgia Power, but with any number of other solar developers or utilities, those renewable energy credits can be monetized on state markets or on a national voluntary market. So there's actually new revenue opportunities for DOTs to utilize their right-of-way existing infrastructure and assets for multitasking and more productivity through strategic public-private partnerships with utilities. Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry. I've been known to be long-winded. Yes, ma'am.
Are we already, Georgia Power is producing energy from those grids already?
They're in the final stages of testing the site for reliability, and the site will be online and producing energy to the grid this month.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. So this is an initial pilot, which means that this was a learning experience for Georgia DOT and Georgia Power. And we're actually only the third state in the nation to pilot this utilization of right-of-way for renewable energy. The first state was Oregon in 2008. Massachusetts has done some small deployments over the last 10 years. So this particular site is not necessarily expected to be one of the most highest cost benefit. Sure. So on the interstate system, really your best opportunity is to develop at the Diamond and Cloverleaf interchanges, which, you know, by landmass naturally limits your size of your developments to, you know, 20 to 30 acres divided into four sections. So naturally these are going to be smaller scale, and that does mean that we cannot capture the economic benefits associated with scale, right? So we're going to miss some of the economies of scale with these projects. But on the flip side, you're right at T&D, right? So you don't have the additional costs of running transmission and distribution hundreds of miles to rural areas. So it's really a trade-off.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Where did they drop that? Or maybe they'll come on later and tell us, but where did they link that to their grid?
So the grid was running alongside Interstate 85 on the other side of the interstate, and so Georgia Power bored under the interstate to connect to their grid, which was just on the other side.
Right, but so they had an inverter that they put in, and they can drop the energy if it's filling up the grid. I mean, I'll ask them when they come. I'm just
sure.
Curious because it a multi-directional flow there. I'm just curious how they know the inverter when it's putting power on and how they control it, because that's probably what we're going to get to later, Mr. Chairman, with the rooftop solar, is how the inverters know when it can and when the grid can and cannot accept the output from the solar system. So I just wondered how they handled it out there.
I would just recognize the benefit that the site produced for the interstate system itself is that Georgia Power has installed 44 high-mast LED lights to light the entire interchange. This exit 14, existed on 12 total miles of unlit interstate because there's no mainline lighting and there's no lighting at exits 13 or 14 previous to this project. So Georgia Power has actually brought a safety benefit to Interstate 85. As a return on investment to the system or a return to the system of benefit. They will operate those lights for the 35-year period, and that also presents us an opportunity with Georgia Power over the next few years to understand what smart highway lighting could be, what sensors, cameras, and other types of technology to use, and how that might function and bring additional benefit to the interstate.
Well, thank you very much for your presentation.
Thank you so much for your time and attention. I really appreciate it.
Very interesting. Very interesting. All right, I'm going to get into this discussion about solar. I guess as it relates to rooftop and utility scale, and y'all have your presentations ready. So that's kind of it. I just kind of wanted to frame it in. We're talking about issues related to the distributed generation. Maybe some of these issues that Chairman Martin brought up. And where you see it going, and what's the future of solar in Georgia? And I think I'm sorry. I guess first on the list, Wilson Mallard, Director of Renewable Development, Georgia Power.
Good to see you.
While Wilson is pulling this up, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, my name is Jamie Hawken. I'm the Director of Legislative Affairs for Georgia Power. Today we have Wilson Mallard with us. Wilson is the Director of Renewable Development. Also, Must Moonlight is an IT consultant based on pulling the video up earlier. Good job. First off, I wanted to thank you for the opportunity to come talk about our distributed generation, our DG program, which includes rooftop solar. And we'd like to commend this committee, the General Assembly, and the PSC as well for really the growth of solar in general here in the state. And we look at growth of solar in Georgia in a very measured, very economic, and market-driven manner that has truly benefited the ratepayers, and so we're very appreciative of that. and I think it's working. If you look at some of the accolades the state has received over the last 5 to 7 years, we are a top 10 state for solar development. Georgia Power as a utility has been recognized as a top 10 utility for solar development, and so we feel like the way that we have brought and adopted solar here into the state is working. And
where have the accolades come from?
Come from SEIA, I guess. It's
a couple of national organizations. One, the Solar Energy Industries Association. Another was the Solar Electric Power Association. Georgia Power ranked in the top 10 last year, and the state of Georgia also ranked in the top 10, including all the renewable development across the state.
So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Wilson, and he's going to jump into more of the DG conversation.
I'm going to do it. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, committee members. Thank you very much for the opportunity. I really appreciate it. We're going to talk DG, but if you'll allow me, let's step back just a little bit and talk big picture renewable marketing.
Yeah, make sure you use the mic. This thing's been webcast, and they can't hear.
Okay. So I love to start with this graph. This graph shows the growth of renewable energy in Georgia Power's portfolio from back in the early 2000s. And it's nothing short of amazing to me. We're in a state that doesn't have an RPS, no sort of renewable goal, and yet through the leadership of the legislature and laws and policies that allowed this growth, the constructive regulation of the Georgia Public Service Commission, and really the collaboration between Georgia Power and the active stakeholder group here in Georgia, we've carved out a market for renewable energy that really is the envy of the nation. We are driven by our principles. We want low cost, high reliable electricity. We want to take advantage of the changes that we're seeing from customer preferences, the changes that the technology is bringing. And I'm just really proud of the way that renewables are growing, and I hope everybody in this room is as well. We really try to add renewables to the system in a way that benefits all of our customers, not just any particular group. And so that's very important to us and very important as we work through the details around procurements and programs at the Georgia Public Service Commission that we do think about all of our customers. It's one of the beauties of the market, the way our electric market works in Georgia. We serve all of our customers. So you really get a lot of economies of scale when you can serve 2.6 million customers with a very diverse mix of generating resources. And we've got a combination here in Georgia of price and reliability that really benefits our entire state, from residential customers who are mainly just interested in turning the lights on, to large industrial customers trying to compete internationally, to new customers considering Georgia that really look favorably upon our price and reliability combination. It really serves us well as we seek to grow the economy of Georgia. And adding more renewables is becoming more and more important to all of our customers. Just quickly on this graph, solar is the predominant source in Georgia. That's yellow, you see that. Green down along the bottom is biomass. We've had a significant biomass market here in Georgia for a while. The blue represents wind resources. Y'all, wind is not a really good resource here in Georgia. It's a much better resource in the Midwest. If you've driven from here to out west recently, you know what Oklahoma and Kansas look like. That wind that we have under contract is actually generated in the Midwest and wheeled over transmission lines here. So there's hope for more wind in Georgia. There's some technology advancements that are coming, but right now, solar is what provides the most value here in Georgia. One last thing before I leave, notice the very small red stripe starting in 2021. That's going to be really important. That represents energy storage. Energy storage is sort of the next technology advancement that's going to impact the way that we generate and deliver electricity. Energy storage is going to allow us to have even larger penetrations of variable resources such as solar and wind, because they don't produce energy all the time, and in order to keep the grid stable and reliable, cost-effective storage is going to be critical as we continue to grow our renewables. Yes, sir. That is a great question. It is, and it's really the first renewable resource. And in fact, Georgia Power's original resources back in the early 1900s were predominantly hydroelectric. There's just not much room for growth of additional hydro. Georgia Power has about 1,000 megawatts of hydro on its system, but it's just not going to change very much. Usually when we're talking about renewables, we're talking about non-hydro resources, just very limited opportunity to be able to grow additional hydro. Absolutely. Lake Oconee is one of the world's largest pump storage hydro facilities. So if you ever spend any time there, you know, to generate power during the day and then overnight turn the turbines back around and pump water back into the lake. That sort of pump storage is also going to be critical, just like battery energy storage, as we continue to grow more solar and wind. It is not. No, there's a, yeah, good point. There's about 1,000 megawatts of hydro on the ground here in Georgia. Other questions?
Any other questions? I wanted to ask, I'm looking to see who else is presenting. I want to ask you while you're there, do you have a any information on how many of your customers, Georgia Power customers, have gone to rooftop solar?
Sure, okay. Sure. And I do have a couple more slides, Mr.
Oh,
Chairman.
I'm sorry.
So
I thought you were finished.
Yeah, let me talk there. I just got three more, I believe. So I did want to talk about distributed generation, as it's part of that mix. Distributed generation is really important element in our renewable portfolio, and it's growing significantly. Not all distributed generation might be what you think about as rooftop solar behind the meter. There's approximately 2,000 customers in Georgia that have rooftop or behind the meter solar, but there's a significant number of additional distributed generation projects that are not behind the meter. They're connected directly to the grid. And as you look at this growth over the last few years and what's projected over the next 3 or 4 years, it's a pretty significant amount of distributed generation. A megawatt's how we measure the instantaneous power flow. Think of a Walmart as using a megawatt of energy at any given time. And so these numbers in the graph are megawatts of solar distributed generation resources that are on the grid. So we're significant. We're north of 200 megawatts of grid-connected DG, another 30 megawatts or so that are behind the meter at customer locations. And as part of the 2019 IRP decision from the Public Service Commission, we got another 210 megawatts that we're going to go procure. So DG is significant in Georgia, but it's maybe not always what you think about. I added this graph up here, and maybe this will be instructional, but we don't have to spend too much time on it. Chairman, when you say rooftop solar, I think probably what most people think about is the schematic on the left-hand side, and that would be where a customer installs solar on the roof of their home or business. They use the energy on site. If they produce more than they use, it can flow back to the grid. If the solar's not producing, either on a cloudy day or at night, energy flows in from the grid, and the utility company, Georgia Power, otherwise keeps up with those flows and allocates the cost and benefits appropriately. One of the ways we've grown distributed generation here in Georgia is through a different method, and that's grid connected. These would be solar facilities that are connected directly to the grid, and they're most likely bigger than just a rooftop installation. They can be similar in size to the right-of-way solar facility that we just looked at, up to about 3 megawatts. Rule of thumb, you could say about 5 megawatts per acre, 5 acres per megawatt, so something in the neighborhood of 12 or 15 acres. But they are connected to the distribution system. We do get some of those economies of scale. You get to drive the prices down significantly there. And through our IRP process, the stakeholders, Georgia Power and the Georgia Public Service Commission, have grown this grid-connected form of distributed generation significantly. And that's where we see a lot of the growth in DG here in Georgia.
Did you have a question, Representative Moore?
Representative Jackson.
Okay, Representative Jackson, if you can hold just for 1 second. I got a couple things on my mind I want to, I'll get back to you in just a minute. I wanted to ask you, so when somebody does have rooftop solar, I guess there's a special meter that they have to have that will actually measure that electricity going back. Is that right?
Yes, sir. Bidirectional meter will measure the electricity flowing both ways.
Okay. And then that what is credited back to the customer is the void, what do you call the voided cost, is that right, of the electricity?
That is. That's correct.
Okay. I said I've forgotten one of my questions, but I do remember one that I was going to ask. I think over the last 7 years, something like that, in the IRPs that the Georgia Power has presented to the PSC, the PSC has, as I understand it, has at least a couple times has added more solar to what they approved in the IRP. Is that correct? Basically,
yes,
they didn't approve the initial presentation that you all presented to them, and it kind of.
That's right.
And I think that the way the statute reads is it has to be approved, that the IRP has to be approved by the PSC. It may not be exactly what it says, but I mean, that's basically the gist of it.
Yes, sir.
It has to be approved.
Correct.
I'm just wondering why, if and with all the success, why didn't Georgia Power offer more solar to begin with? Why did the PSC have to come back and say, I mean, it's been successful, so it seemed like Georgia Power, with the projections they make, would have known if we add more to it, we don't have to go through the process of the PSC saying we need to add more and going through that whole process.
Commissioner, it's not an exact science. it's, Mr. Chairman, it's really trying to consider the benefits that solar brings, but also the potential costs and reliability impacts. We can't just add solar indefinitely. Eventually, because of the intermittent nature of the nature of how solar produces, we can potentially have reliability impacts on the grid. And so one of the things that Georgia Power is adamant about is a measured and deliberate approach. We want to make sure that we don't go too fast too soon. It's also really benefited all the customers of Georgia because the cost of solar continues to come down year after year. Every time we go out for a procurement of solar energy, the cost is less than the time before. Yeah. So this sort of measured, disciplined approach allows us to make sure that we're doing the things we need to do to keep reliability,
right,
what customers expect, but also allows us to take advantage of the cost drops that we continue to see.
And I understand. I appreciate it. It just seems like with, you know, with Georgia Power's ability to project and the success is what's come out of it, they would have known that we could have probably added more even what PSC put in. If we even add double what PSC, we'd still be okay. I guess that's what I'm...
And that's certainly possible, and costs are still coming down. The folks I work with whose job it is to keep the lights on 24/7, 365, they want to make real sure that as we add these intermittent resources, we're doing everything that we need
right.
to do to keep the grid reliable.
And one more question. I remember
sure.
what I was going to ask you. I guess that the number of rooftop in Georgia, as far as your customers are concerned, is not at the point. I understand that if, like in California places, it can become problematic because you can't really control what the customer is doing as far as the usage. Whereas with the utility scale, you have a lot more control of what's happening.
Correct.
There.
Yes, sir.
I mean, would that be true that in Georgia that the number is not great enough that it's caused problems with that, but potentially it could. Is that, am I correct in that?
I think you said it exactly right. Our system operators are really interested in making sure we know exactly what's out there and that we have the ability to communicate and control with it. It is a lot easier to communicate with one large solar facility than it is a lot of distributed facilities, but the technology's there, the communication is there. The new inverters that are being installed, that turns the power from DC to AC, they're smart inverters these days, and they can communicate.
Okay.
And so the utility will have the ability at some point in the future to be able to monitor and to control those facilities.
I believe that Chairman Martin had a question about that, but Representative Jackson had a question first.
Thank you, Chair. Would it be easier to expand the conversation around rooftop to more of a like nano or micro or mini grids? The reason why I say that, because when you think about the grand scheme of things, Mercedes-Benz is its own self-sufficient solar system, right? It provides, or a hospital or a large commercial building like GWCC. I just think that, you know, when you start talking about rooftops, you know, we can sort of get into the technical weeds and it could just take the conversation off where it really wouldn't, it shouldn't be. I think when we expand it to more of a nano grid or a micro grid or like the military base, right? And so I just think it's richer and more texture to the conversation in terms of what renewables, specifically solar, can provide in terms of a mixed use in the state of Georgia.
Absolutely. I think, have you been in my staff meetings in the last month or two?
I'm very familiar with the industry.
Microgrids are the thing, and these large customers want nothing more than resiliency and the confirmation that should reliability have an issue on the grid, that they're able to still island and operate. Now, most all of those customers, the ones you just talked about as examples, they still want to stay connected to the grid. It's really hard to beat the sort of price reliability value proposition that being connected to the
That's
grid
right.
provides. However, they are interested in being resilient. Military is a great example. Hospitals, we can think of lots. And so Georgia Power is active. There's lots of other players in the market active to try to help these customers understand what it takes from a technical perspective, and then what the costs are for that microgrid, and how we sort of share those costs, how we make sure that costs are allocated in the right way. But you're right, it's going beyond just rooftop solar. It's going to how can customers have a system that allows them to continue to operate in times of grid outage.
If I may follow up. So I think we can also help Georgia move forward too in terms of contingencies, because some of these nodes can be a very critical node. And so when you think about the type of events, Mother Nature events can happen in Georgia, when you start talking about distributive power, we can even start, you know, involve colleges in this conversation too. So that way when we get hurricanes or tornadoes and things of that nature, it's easier for utility companies to help optimize Georgia's power even during those events that we cannot control, like a tornado or hurricane, especially on our coastline, Jekyll's Island, et cetera.
I couldn't agree more. And like I said, we are active in trying to sort of solve those requests. You talked about the exact customers that are the most interested. It is the military bases. It is the colleges. It is the hospital, the public power, the folks that really have to have power all the time. And so work is going on. The technical element is one thing to solve, and then sort of the cost and the cost allocation right. question is the next question. But that is becoming a bigger and bigger part of Georgia Power's planning process.
Thank you. Chairman Martin had a question about reverberators.
I don't know what one of those are. I was inverters, maybe. Yeah. So the question about the inverter, I was going back to the Ray, because that line was, I'm going to assume, just a transmission line or a distribution line, depending on the side. So it's just going along out there. I'm going to assume there wasn't a substation right across the street. So when you connected to that line, because of the 1 megawatt that would be put, you know, when that inverter decided to throw a megawatt of, AC current moving at the speed of light, when it pops on there, you have to connect that somewhere back at the control upstream from that, so that it would know when that's coming.
That's right.
You kind of dropped off the peak.
Yeah, interconnection is a big part of these facilities. So finding the spot to put it is one thing,
right.
And then finding a place where the interconnection cost to the grid can be done cost effectively is another.
Well, and that's what I was going to get to the point I was going to try to make is, it would be great to just be able to apply them at every diamond or intersection up and down the road, but there is something to be said for it having – it needs to be at the right place to be productive. So if I can just real briefly – what do you use, and if I missed it while I was outside, I apologize, but what do you use as a utilization factor on solar built in Georgia right now? What do you call the – because you have to have backup power underneath
That's
it.
That's right.
And typically Georgia Power has that, and you have some – a couple more megawatts coming online here in a couple of years. But what is your utilization factor for
sure.
the solar you put online?
For, say, a small rooftop system might be somewhere in the 17% to 20% capacity factor. How many hours of the year does the solar produce? The bigger utility scale systems could be higher than that, 25%, 27%. Some even can be a little higher. A lot of the big utility scale systems have trackers, and
right.
so they're mechanized, they can move and follow the sun, and it can increase the capacity factor.
Okay, so going along to that, I guess I'm to follow up on Chairman Parsons' thing of why not more. Is it kind of the you didn't need that much more capacity in peaking the way you're closing down things? So if I'm hoping the PSC, I don't know if there's anybody from the PSC here that wants to raise their hand and take this critique or compliment, but the PSC that didn't throw it all at you at once mm-hmm. probably did the consumer in Georgia a favor in that. It lets you gradually go to that and then buy as the market went down, because there's only a certain saturation point that you can build and integrate to the grid, over time. Is that fair to say?
Absolutely. And we hold in high regard the regulatory interaction and the work that we do through IRPs and rate cases. And it really is a collaborative process. There really is a lot of compromise. And so to the extent Georgia Power has made a filing, this is what we put forward, is what we think is reasonable. The commissioners hear from lots of different stakeholders. They then take into all that information into account, and eventually we reach a compromise that really has turned out to be a really good value for the customers in Georgia. Did we go as fast as some of the other folks would have wanted us to? Probably not. Did we do more than Georgia Power proposed each IRP? Absolutely, we did. But at the end of the day, it's that constructive regulation and that stakeholder process that really has served the consumer in Georgia very well.
The last thing, and I know Chairman Parsons, I think, did it a couple of years before me, but I went through a certification program from the University of Idaho this summer with some folks from the West Coast that if you will, might have come from states that want to be a green, you know, greener than we're thought about here in Georgia. But the information we got from experts in solar was, be careful you don't pour it out there too fast, because you can in trying to just get it there tomorrow, you can drive the inefficiency up. Is what they actually, and this were people that were very much solar proponents. They just said, let it happen as the market allows and keep it in the mix. You feel like we're doing a pretty good job of that.
I do, and that to back to the energy storage piece, that is really going to be the technology that allows us to continue to grow, because you don't want to go too fast, too quick, like maybe you have in other states, and it can cause some reliability issues or some cost issues. So, I feel really good about the trajectory that we've been on. Anybody that looks at that graph can tell that we're growing, and we are doing it the right way.
No, $10 kilowatt hour power like they had in Texas this summer, right?
Let's try not to do that. Other question I got, let me just close out, if that's okay, then I can open up for any more questions. A quick advert. Do we have more questions? A quick advertisement, Georgia Power is customer service focused. We want to help customers. Anybody that wants to put rooftop solar on their roof, we're here to help them do the analysis. We've also got a whole portfolio of programs that customers can choose from, a community solar program, a simple solar program, so customers can support the renewable industry here in Georgia, even if they're not a good candidate for solar on their rooftop. And then last, just to brag one last time, the results are incredible. The mix, this is a graph showing Georgia Power's resource mix as it's changed from 2007 to projected to 2025. And it's significant, y'all. And economics have driven the solution. We've stuck to our principles, no upward rate pressure on customers, trying to make sure that we capture all the appropriate costs and benefits that renewables bring. It really is a good story to tell. It helps us provide that low-cost, reliable service and to be able to continue to do that for a long time in the future.
Thank you very much. Appreciate you being here in the presentation. That was very informative. Thank you. Jeff Pratt and I think also Heather Tillay from going to present from the perspective of the EMCs.
Chairman and members of the committee, my name is Heather Tillay. I'm the Senior Vice President of External Affairs for Oglethorpe Power. We are the wholesale energy provider to 38 electric cooperatives. So we own and operate power plants. We co-own some power plants with our partners, George Power and MEAG. And we wholesale that energy directly to the consumer. I'm sorry, to the EMCs, and then the EMCs then distribute that to the consumer. We work very closely with our sister company, Green Power EMC. And so Jeff Pratt, the CEO of that organization, is here to speak to you today. Most of you have met Jeff Pratt before. He has presented to this committee, I think, in this very chair. And just as recently as October, invited many of you out to come tour a solar facility where we had some special visitors of the furry variety that I'll remind you of. But thank you. I'll just pass it off to Jeff Pratt.
Chairman, thank you very much for the invitation. Appreciate being here and have an opportunity to share with you, give you an update really on what's going on with you with the cooperatives with respect to solar in Georgia. And you'll find that the remarks kind of lay into what's going on with distributed generation to some extent and how we're further engage our customers in that regard. Make sure I've, here we go. So many of you were able to attend the Covington event we had not too long ago in where we showcased one of the smaller, I would call it, distributed sort of projects that we had out there that had these furry friends with us, and that was the sheep that interrupted our conversations quite often. They were a lot of fun, but I toward the end of the presentation, I want to talk a little bit more about where that's going and what it means for even our larger projects in Georgia. You'll see the map here has many renewable energy projects. The yellow circles are the ones that are in service today. Many of them are quite large, but many of them, especially around Atlanta, are much more distributed. The gray dots are the ones that we have on the on tap to become in service in the next 3 years. So we have a lot going on. I want to share just to give you a quick update on that and how it relates to how that fits with our customers. In 2010, we had a very active biomass market in Georgia, and still do today. But that made up a huge number of our solar and a renewable engagement with our customers, which are the electric cooperatives. That was equivalent to about 640 acres of solar, and it was the largest renewable program in the state at that time. And not counting our hydroelectric assets, which are still there as well, which aren't reflected directly in most of mine either. So in 2018, though, just this past year, we had 280 megawatts installed and operational. So it's grown dramatically, and look what's happened to the circles in the sense that solar's become a dominant player, and that's by virtue of the geography that we're in. And we do have a small certified run-of-river hydro facility we've had for many years that continues to remain in that mix as well. And then lastly, though, the 1,200 megawatts that we have coming online very soon, which will be the remainder of the portfolio, I want to give you a sense of what that means to the cooperatives. That is probably one-third of all of the solar that cooperatives in the country are engaged in today and have put in place. So these 38 co-ops out of over 900 in the United States have done about a third of the solar and engaged in about a third of that. And I think that's really telling of the leadership that they've had in the country with respect to co-ops to this point. I can tell you I won't be able to have this slide up here much longer. The others are catching on and they're doing well, but maybe one more year here, Chairman. So we apply these resources, our cooperatives apply them in different ways to their different membership constituents where it really means something to them. One of the most interesting ways we really pioneered this cooperative solar community solar program in the state, and it really plays well for customers who don't have the cash to put solar on the roof, customers who can't lease their property or rent their property but still want to be engaged with solar personally, or want to try it out, see what it looks like. This program is designed so that customers can see the effects of solar on their bill just as though they owned it on the rooftop, but not have a lot of the burdens with operating and maintenance that goes along with that. And it's cost effective as well. We can build these facilities for about half the cost of what it costs to put it on a rooftop today. Now that may change over time, but we find it as a real value point to our members. We share information with them to help them see in real time what's going on, and it really helps them understand both the challenges and the opportunities of rooftop solar. So we're hoping that this helps with their education and understanding, which is an important part of any distributed DG rooftop engagement. We've also leveraged these projects with our industrial customers. You'll find that most industrial customers in the state of Georgia are becoming more and more centric around green energy. They want to make sure it's important to them. Their benchmark is their customers. More and more of our customers, as well as theirs, are millennials who are right in line and thinking about renewable energy as an important part of their business. And these customers want to be a part of that. So we're leveraging our commercial and large scale projects with a lot of these entities to help them engage and become, in their words, in their benchmarks, 100% renewable. And it's been very successful both economic development, creating jobs, and I think it's a good story and real successful for the state of Georgia. Two more slides here, Chairman. We have regenerative energy. I want to introduce that because it relates to taking these tens of thousands of acres of solar that used to be productive farmland and we're producing solar energy instead of maybe peanuts or cotton, but we're working to bring some of that back into a agriculture community. Most of our 10,000 acres are planned to be what we call regenerative energy, and that is we're going to very carefully and are very carefully managing the grasslands that are underneath the solar modules, doing managed grazing, and it will result in carbon sequestration and storage on the property in the soil. But it's not a put the sheep out there and let them run, which is a lot of fun, but it really is a science to this process of continuing farming and agriculture on lands that are actually producing good quality energy today. So thank you very much. That's my prepared remarks.
Thank you. Appreciate it. I'm glad you mentioned that cooperative solar. I was wanting to ask the question a while ago, but I couldn't think how to frame that exactly what it is. I've heard about that. Basically, it's allowing customers to do sort of the same thing as if they had rooftop solar. For whatever reasons, they can't do it. Not good sunlight coming in, trees and whatever, but it's a way of doing it and kind of doing the same thing as I understand it. So I appreciate you talking about that.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Yeah. And that was a great trip down there where you had the sheep, and
it makes those solar panels that are kind of they don't move and talk and play much, but yeah. the sheep made it kind of fun, didn't it?
Pretty interesting guys. You know, we're sitting there, sitting in our seats, and all of a sudden a sheep come up to you and look at you right in the face, and wants to ask a question himself.
That's right.
Chairman Dickey, do you have a question?
Just briefly, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I really appreciate. You're pioneering this and being in the solar. I also want to do a shout out. I've got one project in my district, the landfill gas renewable too that really works really well too. And I know we're all concerned about our landfills and those, but capturing that gas, running it, generating through diesel motors, that's really a great project too.
Those are imperative in the whole carbon sequestration and minimizing greenhouse gases that go to our environment. We don't want a lot of landfills, and we don't want to put a lot of, but as we do it, we might as well capture the more harmful methane and use it for good. And the good is that we reduce its impact from 20%, 20 times to 1 times, and gather energy that we can use to our grid. So it's been very helpful. Thank you for mentioning that.
I don't see any further questions. Thank you very much. Appreciate the presentation. Mr. Giles, did you have anything else? Okay, very good. I just want to give you the chance. And the last presenter on this is James Marlowe.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, it's great to be with you today. If y'all will bear with me just a moment as I attempt to open up this presentation. I have been doing solar for quite a long time. Mr. Chairman, the first time we actually had much time together, we were on Capitol Hill with the Department of Energy for the solar decathlon. So there's a long history of work. I've been involved as the founder of Radiant Solar. I've worked on almost every type of solar project in Georgia over the past 12 years. I was responsible for leading an effort for 12 Electric Cities projects early in the day. I've worked closely with my colleagues and friends at Georgia Power, my colleagues and friends at Green Power. I've done many projects with them. I personally worked with the team that put some solar panels on top of Georgia Power's headquarters. Not a lot of people can say that. It's been a great thing. I've really enjoyed the work we've done. And really the most important thing I hope you'll get from me today, that solar has really been good for Georgia. It's really been good for rural Georgia. It's been good for our utilities, as you've just heard. It's been good for consumers, for ag, and for our DOD installations. that it is safe, reliable, and clean. And I also want to tell you a little bit about the rate of change. The rate of change is happening fairly significantly. I also want to bust a few myths. There are a lot of myths in the solar industry, and as a person that's been doing it for a long time, I think I have a little bit of credibility on some of those myths. And then I have a call to action for us as we work together with my colleagues in the utility space. And I'm very pro-utility. I think I'm sometimes a catalyst for change and an innovator, but I enjoy working with my utility colleagues. And electricity is incredibly important. The lights that we're using right now, the lights that power our red lights and our stop lights, they power our intensive care units. Electricity is really, really important for Georgia and our citizens. But solar has been good for Georgia. We've got a colleague in the room that was the third solar person in Georgia. Maybe he was the second, Keith Freeman over here. But I was number four, and now there are about 4,000 of us. There are several of us in the room here. But we make a living in Georgia in the solar energy business, and we're mostly small businesses, and we've built these projects on top of residences, on schools, in large fields in South Georgia. And there's really been about $3 billion invested, and there's another $7 billion that's coming. So if you look at what's under contract, what's in the IRP, what's happening with green power, this is a very significant industry that is similar in size to film and entertainment, which people talk a lot about because it's really cool. But it's been a great force for good. I've been involved in projects in rural Georgia, down in Millen, Georgia, and Camilla, Georgia, and other places, and we were the first investment in some of those communities in decades. And those property taxes are going to be a big help to those schools and those counties and those small cities that we worked in, and I'm really proud of that work. I care deeply about rural Georgia. I'm from rural Georgia. We've also worked with Georgia Power around DOD installations, so whether it's Fort Stewart in Representative Werkhauser's area down in coastal Georgia, or Fort Benning, or a giant project that Georgia Power is now building at Warner Robins. These things are good for our state, and solar is very much a Georgia-grown industry. So the jobs in this look like these colleagues of mine out in the field. That's actually at Walton EMC's solar array behind their headquarters, or in the manufacturing facility in Dalton, Georgia, that employs 650 people at Hanwha Qcells. So there are a couple of different jobs there. There's a lot going on there, and I'm glad Wilson showed the 2025 slide. I didn't have that one, but I have the 2023 slide. What's interesting to me about this, and when I started, there was really no solar in Georgia. It was just some homes up in North Georgia. But soon we're going to be equal to nuclear power and then surpass nuclear power in the energy mix. And the reason we're doing that is because it's the lowest cost way to build solar now. The economics of solar energy are the best economics, primarily because there's no fuel cost. So we have a fuel-free risk asset that requires minimal maintenance, and it's a great addition to Southern Company and Georgia Power's fleet. But pausing for a minute, kind of talking about this rate of change, everybody in this room has a phone in their pocket, and the iPhone's only 12 years old. So there's an awful lot happening in the environment right now, and even over the last month, there have been major announcements in the financial world with BlackRock and Bezos, BlackRock manages $7 trillion, and they're disinvesting in coal. Bezos is making big investments. PepsiCo and Visa, a little airline that's headquartered here, they're all moving in this direction because it's the right thing to do for their businesses. You see Athens, Atlanta, Augusta, and potentially soon to be Savannah that are passing legislation and policy around 100% renewable energy. And it's important that they work with their utilities to accomplish these goals. Some of the basics in Georgia. We are a leader in solar in Georgia. That's principally large-scale utility solar. We are behind in distributed generation, and I'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. But when you see Facebook coming to Georgia and they say, we're going to invest several billion dollars in a data center, and we want 400 megawatts of solar. So that's really about $500 million of an investment in solar. Those are good things for our state. When you see SK Batteries coming to Commerce, Georgia, with 2,000 jobs to make batteries, which will primarily be used by Volkswagen cars, that's a very good thing for our state. The Hanwha Qcells, which I mentioned earlier, has 650 jobs and potentially more. Our DOD bases, the fact that they now all have solar is good in the event of a BRAC in the future, where those bases might be at risk or be compared to other bases that don't have solar. the rural Georgia, we talked a little bit about that. The primary benefit for our rural communities is the property taxes paid on these assets over their 25 to 35 year life. And that's a very, very important thing. In Mitchell County, the first 20 megawatt that I was involved with, first 20 megawatts east of the Mississippi, it will put a couple of million dollars into the school system over that 25 year life of that asset. That's a really big deal for a small rural county. And there's also a lot of ag processors that are using solar to improve their operations. Our EMCs, as Jeff has mentioned, are a leader in the Southeast. Walton EMC, they've been a pleasure to work with. I built many projects with them and have worked with them very closely. Southern Company is the number two owner of solar in North America. NextEra is the largest. Southern Company is number two. So there's a few myths out there. About 10 years ago, I actually had to wage a campaign in Georgia that there was good sun in Georgia, that there were people that had propagated that there was not sufficient sun in Georgia, and it was a myth. And fortunately, we got the facts out there, and that the success that we built in becoming a top 10 state is based on busting that myth. Right now, there's a myth out there that only large-scale solar works, that you can't do rooftop, you can't do small solar. And that's a myth. It's wrong. It's false. It's not based on facts. There are millions of rooftop solar installations in America. There's a million in California alone. There's a million in Australia. And there's about a million in Europe. There are 2,000 customers in Georgia. There's a lot more than that in South Carolina, a lot more than that in North Carolina because of policy differences. But large scale only as a solution is a myth. It's factually incorrect. There's also a myth that rooftop solar is not safe or practical or economical. It has different economics than very large-scale projects, but it has a role to play. If we put all of our solar in southwest Georgia under a single weather pattern, we're losing some of the benefits of distributed generation. There are savings for transmission. There are savings for distribution. Usually GE would tell you that's about 4 to 6% in line loss. So having solar near the point of consumption is a better paradigm, a better model. Lastly, there's a myth going around the Capitol now that solar panels can't be recycled. Solar panels are made of silicon, glass, aluminum, which are highly recyclable. Now, there are some specialized panels, like a first solar panel, that has to have a special treatment. But other than that, the racking, the aluminum on a roof rack, the copper wire, the aluminum wire, all those are recyclable. So this is a very benign asset when compared to other energy classes. So these are all myths that you as leaders, I hope, will help us propagate. Let's get the facts out there. Let's work with Georgia Tech and other very authoritative bodies to work on this. But these myths are busted. You know, these are things that we need to nip in the bud right now and talk about the economics of not just large-scale solar, but rooftop and distributed generation solar, and a mix of all of the above is really the right answer. So my call to action for you is really more solar, and I think all the solar industry will agree with that. More distributed generation. You may have people that think, no, large scale is only the way to go for their business model, but there are other business models. We need to do radically more energy storage. Right now there's about 80 megawatt hours installed of solar in the state. We need to quickly make that 800. We need to do more with EVs and electric transportation. Those batteries that people are making in Commerce, Georgia, that go in Volkswagens and that go in other electric vehicles are good for our state. They also help with our air quality, and they help with other areas in economic development across the supply chain. We also need to do more electrification. So as we use electricity, it's a very elegant form of energy, and we need to do more electrification. So these are some things that I hope you'll think about, I hope you'll study. If we do have a few more minutes, I do have some pictures I'd like to share, or if we're short on time, I'll defer those to another time.
How long would it take?
2 minutes.
2 minutes?
So, first of all, solar is really a simple technology. You have five components. You have a solar panel. You have an inverter, which we talked about earlier. An inverter converts DC power to AC power. It also is the brains that regulates it, controls it, and turns it off if there's a need to turn it off. You also have a monitor that will typically be connected to the internet so you can look at it and see if it's working. And then you have wires and conductors and then a racking system. It's really pretty simple. They're very minimal maintenance and they last a long time. This is what a big plant looks like. So this was a plant I was involved in. It was the first 20 megawatt facility built east of the Mississippi, and it occupies about 120 acres of land. It's in Camilla, Georgia. It's connected to Georgia Power at their Cotton substation, and it's been a very successful plant, exceeding its production every year. This is the rooftop of IKEA at Atlantic Station. I always say this is bigger than my hometown of Lincoln, but this is what a megawatt looks like on a roof, and it's been up there for a number of years, and it's done exactly what it was designed to do, and it's had minimal to no maintenance. This is the Atlanta Falcons canopy that Georgia Power built right in the marshalling yards right by Atlanta Falcons. So there are lots of parking lots that would be available for solar canopies. It's a very economical way to go out and add solar if a rooftop option is not available. This is the Georgia Power University of Georgia Research Station, a project I was very proud to be a part of. But this is testing all types of solar technology right there near the practice field off Millage in Athens, Georgia. This is an energy storage collection of photos. So you see the Tesla Powerwall, which many people have read about in the press. Sonnen Battery actually has their North American headquarters here in Atlanta. And they have a significant number of employees, and they're growing really well. They're doing a really great job. The top picture would be of more of a medium-scale utility installation. Larger installation would use a lot of shipping container-sized devices. But that's a quick snapshot of what's going on with solar, and I'm honored to be with you today, and I appreciate the time to be with you.
Thank you. Thank you for the presentation. I think we have a question here, if you care to take it.
Yes, yes, I welcome your questions.
A couple of questions regards this. I mean, you say we need to go to solar, and the gentleman before you said, you know, we're going to solar as we need it because the costs keep dropping. It worries me to have a policy position drive to a less than efficient source of energy. If we let things go, prices keep coming down, then you naturally get to the flow for energy. And I'll say that because you also said we have 80 megawatts of backup. We need to go to 800. They have a huge battery backup in just outside of L.A. I think it's 100 megawatts in one place. Maybe you're familiar with the facility.
Yes,
and,
I am.
And essentially it'll keep lit, you know, a couple of blocks of L.A. for 8 hours, and then it'll be gone. And it costs, you know, thousands of dollars per megawatt hour. So I guess my question is, certainly over time, efficiencies are going to get there. But it seems like when policymakers inject and say, we want you to do it right now, we're spending other people's money to do that. It's great Facebook wants to build 400 megawatts of solar. And whoever's building that, whatever EMC's doing it, I hope they're charging Facebook for it, not their ratepayers. Because if 400 megawatts of solar, that's awesome for them to do that. But using the 20-25% utilization, somebody's got to be paying for base load underneath that, and that gets spread over the use. So help me understand where we match the, you know, everything we've heard today, and people that want us go to solar for the sake of solar, not for the sake of what's not always. I won't say that it can't be in some cases, but not always for the case of keeping the cost of energy as low as possible to have, you know, clean, reliable, affordable energy, and just let it happen over time. I mean, we didn't make everybody sell their horses when the Model T came about, but over time they figured out this was the way to go, and I feel like that's what's going to happen here. So
I think that's a great question. And that a phrase I often use is that we want to right-size solar. You know, you don't want to do too much, but you don't want to do too little. And I think sometimes in our utility planning processes, which are very thoughtful processes, they don't understand technology in a way that I do. And that if they go back over these 12 years I've been working with Georgia Power and others, they realize I've been right a pretty high percentage of the time. That this technology is innovating very, very rapidly. And the price compression in solar is dropped over 80% in the last 10 years. So You know, we started out building solar projects. We were near $10 a watt, and now there are projects being built for under $1 a watt. So what was once very expensive and uneconomic, like these cell phones in our pocket, is now very affordable and very accessible. The same thing is true with energy storage, is that it has dropped very radically in price, and like computers, it will continue to do that, but there are a lot of benefits to that. In LA, there were other benefits than just saying we're going to plop a battery down. They had a weak grid, they had a weak circuit, and they used a battery to shore up a weak grid without, you know, you can't just plop a gas, natural gas plant down in the middle of the city. We couldn't do that here in Atlanta. With, you know, Georgia Power closed a coal plant because of air quality and other issues. What I'm asking you to do is look at this in its totality. Look at the benefits of Georgia jobs, of economic development, of using technology that is commercially viable today, and evaluating it constantly. You know, the rate of change in this technology doesn't allow our utilities to say, we're just going to evaluate that every 3 years, or we're going to evaluate it over a 10-year interval. So, you know, it's just my perspective as a technologist.
Fair enough, and
I'm a businessman. You know, I've got to make the numbers work. And the thing is, these numbers work. And they're working even as we scale it. And, you know, Wilson showed you that graph with all that. They didn't do that because it was they were doing it for green reasons. They did it for economic reasons.
But that's my point. And again, I this is a great conversation. I don't mean it to be adversarial at all. Mm-hmm. But it's hard for me to tell somebody, and I've been with the gentleman at Green Power. I've been down when we opened a place a couple of years ago down there, and I talked to some commissioners down there. And I asked her, I said, how can we help you? You know, I represent Atlanta. And she said, you know, help us keep the price of power low. She said, I have people I represent that have to make a decision between if they're going to pay for their medicine or their electric bill. So it's hard for me to, you know, I don't buy the situation of I want to create Georgia jobs by installing solar if it makes grandma pay more for her power. So I'm with you on that too.
Yeah, I'm with you on that. My mom's 83.
Okay, but you understand, a lot of people say that we create Georgia jobs by installing solar.
Right.
That's fine if they want to buy them. I mean, we could create that through a lot of things. So I'm with you all along. And to me, what we need to remove as policymakers, and help me out here, is we need to remove anything that's prohibiting solar from happening.
You and I agree. I'm not here asking for mandates. I'm not here asking for subsidies. I am asking for the removal of barriers. So the reason we only have 2,000 rooftop or behind-the-meter systems in Georgia is because there are additional policy barriers that make it harder to do that. South Carolina has a lot more rooftops than we do. North Carolina has a lot more rooftops. So there are policy barriers. Some of those are regulatory. Some of those are by the utilities themselves. I mean, there's a utility here in Metro Atlanta that's got the worst solar policy in the state. And they're preventing their customers from going solar because of their policies. So this is fairly complicated. Well, they have surcharges and additional fees. In the solar industry, we call it a fine or a penalty. You have to pay a penalty to use a technology. As a person that believes in property rights, I don't think that's a very good thing.
Well, we'll take this offline a bit, but I suspect some of that may be that they want to charge people for using, you know, the grid when they need it. But I'd love to talk to you about it because I'm all for people being able to do that as long as the people that are wealthy and can afford to do it don't push the cost on the grid on people that can't afford to do
Chairman
it.
Chairman Martin.
Yes,
I appreciate.
Let's talk further.
I'm a little passionate about this. If you hadn't figured it out,
I know you are. We've had a lot of discussions about this, and I appreciate your passion and I appreciate your knowledge. I really do. Chairman Martin, if you didn't know, he's the chairman of the Energy Subcommittee in this committee. I rely on him a lot, and I appreciate it. But maybe we need.
I got it all from me,
but. But thank you very much. I appreciate that, and appreciate you coming.
It's a pleasure to be with you. Thank you.
I don't see any other questions. I want to go ahead and wrap it up here. I do want to reference something that Jeff Pratt from Green Energy said a while ago, and that the solar is a Georgia-growing energy source. And, you know, my first involvement in this at all a few years ago, about 10 years ago, I guess it was 10, 11 years ago, was just the thinking about the fact that Georgia has – we have no – We have no oil. We have no coal. If we have any natural gas, it's not being, it's hard to get to and probably will never be drilled and produced. So this is a, you know, solar is a source of energy that we have right here that we can take advantage of. And Georgia certainly is not one of the states that has the least sunshine. We have, you know, we have a good bit here. So I think, you know, given the fact that we don't have other sources and given the fact, too, and this is something that even, you know, I know with horizontal drilling and a lot of things, you know, we have, you know, the projections are we have a lot more of the traditional sources of energy. It's still, they're finite. I mean, at some point they're going to, you know, not beyond when we're not here, but at some point those things are not there anymore. They're not there. And we have to think about that. We have to think about, you know, people with illnesses and things that some of the traditional sources of energy and the use of those in production of electricity create problems for. I mean, we have to think of all these things. And also think of the fact that, you know, Chairman Martin, you had mentioned about the policymakers. You know, we're the policymakers, but we have no energy policy. Well, we do things, you know, in a piecemeal way. And our Public Service Commission, and I'm happy that they've, you know, that they have insisted on some additional solar in the IRPs. I'm glad they have. I think they could have actually insisted on more, but I'm glad that they've done what they have. But they're not even a policy body. They're a regulatory body. It's not even their job to do that. It's our job. It's the job of the legislature and the governor to set policy. So I think that we probably should do more. And I think that especially Georgia Power needs to be pushed. I mean, I think they do a great job. I mean, I admire them tremendously, and I appreciate the fact of what they do. They produce electricity that's, you know, relatively inexpensive compared to other states, and it's reliable. I mean, I appreciate that very, very much. But like any big institution, and I remember I was with the old AT&T, the Bell system. If somebody could have pushed that gigantic organization harder, then they would have moved along much, much further and would probably, many things we take for granted today, the cell phones, the long distance and everything would have happened much earlier, much cheaper. But it was an organization that couldn't be pushed, and sometimes I feel that way with Georgia Power. I admire them, and I think they do a fantastic job. I think they need to be pushed, and we need more. We need more solar. But I think that the presentations today did exactly what and produced the information, you know, pretty much exactly what I was wanting to get out of this. And with that, I think we have a question.
I don't have a question, Mr. Chairman. I just want to say I've been on this committee my whole career, almost 10 years, and I'm real proud of your leadership. On this committee and how our state has progressed with this energy and telecommunications. And I you know, with it's to Chairman Martin, we've got some of the cheapest, most not cheapest, the most economical power of anywhere in the country. And I think that was not by chance. And I think I'm pretty proud of this committee, what it's done, and policymakers. I remember one presentation we had a few years back from some people from Germany talking about their solar. And if you read what's happened to prices for energy in Germany, it's been devastating to their manufacturing thing. And so I think we've had under your leadership, we've really had a good march forward and positive for this state. So.
Well, thank you. I appreciate you saying that. I'm just talking about goals need to be set sometimes further, or you'll never. You know, if you don't reach out a little bit, you're never going to reach them. I mean, I think that we're very fortunate in this state. I really do, and very proud of our EMCs and the Georgia Power, these electric cities. I'm proud of all of them, and I think they do a good job. I just think that I think that's part of what we are. Part of what we need to do is kind of push a little bit harder, and because we want Georgia to always be at the forefront and be leaders. And with that, Chairman Martin, did you want to argue or anything? We can do that.
I move to adjourn, Mr. Chairman.
All right. Meeting is adjourned. Thank you.
Hey, Representative Clark. Hey.